Okay, good morning, goddammit. Piss and vinegar day. I really don't know. Chest and triceps. So, I've done MMA twice today. I did 3 hours of MMA in total. And I'm pretty tired. Workout might be a bit suffered, but that's okay. Because I'm cutting weight, so really, I'm just trying to build up this left arm at this point. Back to neutral. Maintain everything else. Lose weight. Get all the fat that I gained during the injury period off, and then start a bulk and get everything back to square one and beyond. Anyway, today I want to talk about the fact, or at least my theory, I think it's a fact though, that high intensity training could solve the world's fat. Maybe not fat, but it would in a way, and I'll get to that in a second, but I think the high intensity training could solve the world's weakness problem. We could get people to stop being weak and get a lot of medical conditions out of the way and get a lot of different life expectancies up and just generally make people way stronger and healthier if we mass produce the idea of high intensity to the masses. But first I'm going to do a set of incline presses, but I'm going to talk about that because I really do generally believe that. And let me explain why, because I think there's a bunch of reasons why high intensity training could genuinely save the world. Whoa, fuck, it's so hard to stabilize this stupid fucking exercise with one arm. I'm just gonna do a maintenance dose. Keep a few reps in reserve. Oh. Today is not gonna be high intensity by any means. I'm fucking knackered. And the left arm, I'll do maybe some reps to failure, but right arm, I'm doing maintenance with the right arm right now anyway. So even though I'm gonna be talking about high intensity saving the world, this workout's not gonna be high intensity. But anyway, let's see how we go. Let's see if this left side's progressed. Stronger, good. That's a rep in reserve even there, but right now I'm doing 6 to 8 reps, and if I hit the 8th rep on my left, then I progress it, because this doesn't need to go to failure. It still will adapt with plenty of reps in reserve until it's fully back to, you know, advanced state or whatever. All right, so high intensity training saving the world. Well, the first things first really is, for the general populace, high intensity training is the best form of training because it's the most adherable. It is much easier for someone to hear that they can train their full body once a week, upper lower, twice a week, push pull split, whatever. Ideally probably upper lower or full body, because if you do upper lower, you train 20 minutes twice a week, 40 minutes in total, less than an hour in the 162 hours in a week, whatever it is. Really quite easy for someone to hear that and say, really? Huh, okay. So in my own experience, training clients, I've got some clients who are go-getters, and then I also have clients who are just not interested. They want the results, but they cannot be fucked. And with those clients, contrary to popular belief, I give them high intensity training because everyone thinks high intensity training is hard and it's, you know, hardcore and that's why people don't do it. No, I've already talked about this. High intensity is easy because it takes like no time at all. It's very easy for someone to come in for 30 minutes, do a set of legs to failure, do a set of a press to failure, a set of a pull to failure, and then some abs to failure, and get 90% of what they need to get done, build plenty of muscle and strength, especially when you first start, and then get out. That's easy. What's not easy is for people to hear, all right, we're gonna be doing, you know, 25 minutes of cardio and then 45 minutes of weights, or 15 minutes of cardio and 45 minutes of weights, 3 times a week, 3 hours a week. People go, fuck that, I promise you this. So for a lot of people, if you could just say to them, look, you're gonna build a lot of muscle and strength from simply doing essentially an hour of work a week, if that, then most people would go, at least give it a try. And again, like when you first start training, you don't have to isolate biceps and forearms and traps and neck. Most people don't even care about that shit. They just want to be, you know, more functional, move around, feel healthier, feel stronger, see a bit of muscle tone. And even then, like if you're doing a pull up to failure or a pull down to failure or a, you know, bench press to failure, there's a bunch of indirect stimulus. So they're gonna get biceps, they'll get triceps, they'll get grip strength. And then that's, it's a cascading effect too, because you get a client or a person in who's like, yeah, look, I'm cool with doing 30 minutes once a week, but you do 30 minutes once a week for 6 months, which is very easy to do. After 6 months, they're like, well, since I'm doing this, let me adjust my diet. Let me try at least, because I've got all this like new found strength and muscle tone. And I can get off the chair easier, my back doesn't hurt as much, and you know, my blood pressure's gone down, and my you know, diabetes, your blood sugar levels have stabilized more. Maybe I should just compound this effect when I'm already here, and they're already in the habit, and so then, I don't know, maybe they try something else, like they go into a calorie deficit, or maybe they start adding cardio, or maybe they go, all right, let's do push-pull legs, because that way I can isolate my arms a little bit more. And then they do, you know, high intensity 3 times a week, 20 minutes a day, still only doing an hour of work a week, but they, you know, start hitting more muscle groups and they get a bit more interested in it. Whereas if you just try to hit people with a bunch of shit at first, like, you know, you have to do cardio 3 hours a week and weights 3 hours a week and you have to get into a heavy deficit, they'll burn out and say, fuck that. But if you give someone just the idea of doing weights, because out of everything, apart from losing weight and getting a calorie deficit, weights is then the next most important thing to do. You can make your heart barely twice as strong. You can make a muscle within 6 months, easily 5-6 times stronger. So you can get muscle tone and strength like that, right? And then once that comes, you start then going, okay, let's introduce this. Introduce this now, introduce this. They're already in the habit. So high intensity could save a fuck ton of people in the sense that most people could probably do 20 minutes of really hard effort once a week. A leg, a push, a pull, and an ab movement, all done to failure, 20 minutes max, and you're done. And here's the thing, you can really break it down really simplistic. If you put it in the perspective that realistically, if you're just getting that really lazy person in, and this is what I do with new clients who are very lazy. If you get them in, you don't have to train them to failure, because not only does failure not really it's not needed when you first start, because you still adapt to just about anything. Plenty of reps in reserve give you the same results as going to failure when you first start, because you're just so unadapted. And then two, you don't even want to do that for a safety perspective, because like they don't have the connective tissues yet to even do that safely. So if you have someone in and go, okay, we're going to do a leg press, and the first 3 reps, they're not even going to be that hard. Then the last maybe 2 reps are going to be pretty difficult, but not that hard even still, because it's going to be reps in reserve, you're going to be suffering for two reps per set, basically. Like, if you really break it down to someone, like, in this mental context, they sort of catch it. They're like, huh, if I think about it like that, this is almost impossible not to do. So if you go, okay, look, there's going to be two reps where you're going to be struggling to a moderate degree for maybe 5 seconds times four. So for the leg, for the push, for the pull, and for the ab, there's going to be 20 seconds in a maybe 15-minute period of time in general where you're going to be moderately suffering. How fucking hard is that to do? And when you do that, you're going to build a bunch of muscle and strength and stability and function that makes you feel happier and healthier. If someone doesn't want to do it at that point, then dude, fuck them. They're like, there's no hope for a person like that. But if you could tell that to 8 billion people on the planet, and well, or the people that don't already work out, let's say, however many there are, which is quite a lot, and they still say, nah, it's not for me, then fuck them. They've got their own, you know, they make their own grave. But I think a lot of people would be like, oh, hold on, 20 seconds of difficulty? Wow, that doesn't sound too hard. So yeah, if you really break it down to a logical perspective, and then over time, you get acclimatized to it and you start pushing harder and harder as you get used to it. When you first start brushing your teeth as a child, you fucking hate it. Now you do it subconsciously. So I think high intensity could save a lot of people for that reason alone. It takes no fucking time and it takes fuck all effort. All right, maintenance set of decline press for the right arm. This one's getting pretty close, I think, by maybe the end of, not next week, but the week after, I'll be one-to-one with a lot of my pressing strength, and then training will be a lot more fun again. I'll start being just progressively overload without gatekeeping anything or maintaining anything, or just be square even, hopefully. This is a big one for trainers too. Is the thing about trainers is they like to gatekeep and overcomplicate things. They'll give you Bosu ball squats and fucking, you know, resistance band handstand push up, fucking backflip, fucking whatever. You like to bullshit. And so if you say, you know, if a PT, if you know, like if I say to a PT, hey, you have a better chance with holding onto a client if they're lazy by making the workout overwhelmingly fucking simple and easy, they'll go, oh, but then they'll think they can go out on their own. It's like, okay, then let them. If they think they can, they will, and then they won't do it. They'll, you know, they won't adhere to it. Or maybe they'll be more likely to adhere to it because you gave them the high intensity thing. But man, if you're a PT, you should care more about the person being fit than your money, right? And by caring about someone being more fit, you'll make more money. It's just that simple. And so if you get someone in and say, all right, I'm not gonna make you do fucking 60 minutes of exercise. Let's do 30 minutes max with a bit of stretching and bullshit at the end, yeah? Because otherwise, literally, if you're totally honest, then you'll be like, let's have you here for 15 minutes. And then people will just be like, what's the point? So say at 30 minutes, we're going to do four exercises, fucking rep and reserve, high intensity training style, simple as shit, slow tempo to make sure that their mind muscle connection is enacted and they're safe. What they're going to realize is, well, when I go to that guy, I don't hate exercise and I can adhere to it. I'm going there all the time because, well, it's not that bad. And so they're not going to then go, well, because this guy made it so fucking easy for me, let me leave him. They're going to go, no, people aren't like that. Maybe some people are, but most people are going to go, well, this guy has cured my lack of discipline and exercise, so I'm just going to stick with this guy. And that's been the case for me with a lot of clients that come to me who are lazy. I just go, all right, fuck it, high intensity training it is, which is what I already train. And they love it and they get great results and they don't go. And this thing is, they all know how to do it now. It's really not hard to do a basic high intensity novice intermediate program. You go in, you do one or two leg exercises to failure, right? Then you do two pushes, horizontal and vertical. You do two pullers, vertical and horizontal. You do a bicep variation of whichever you care about. You do a tricep to any option you care about. You do a face pull if you have, you know, postural issues. And then you do a plank to failure. That's fucking easy as shit. Anyone can do that after maybe 2 months of instruction. But people, out of respect, or maybe they understand that if they have a trainer, they're even more likely to do it, because they might then find if they go on their own, they won't do it. But at the very least, this specific message then also should be that if you're a trainer, just give clients high intensity training. They're gonna fucking adhere to it. They're not gonna then blood you when they're like, it's a cold day and they don't wanna come in and do fucking 1 hour of bullshit volume workouts, give them the same results as high intensity does. Don't get me wrong, when you're new to the gym, volume makes more sense because you don't need that much intensity, which means you can get more frequency, which means more gains quicker. But for most people, they're not looking to build, you know, 100 kilo bench press in 1 year. Most people are coming in just to be generally strong and fit. They don't like care about like the novice standards of a 140 kilo squat or 180 kilo deadlift. Like, you might get guys in like that and they don't need high intensity. You just give them fucking novice programming, yeah? And then probably put them on high intensity later on because people get bored. That's the other thing. If you're a trainer, people will like novice training for the first year or two. Then they get bored. They're like, all right, the novelty of this fitness shit's wearing off. So then you go, all right, let's go from 3 times a week, 5x5 fucking novice programming, to just doing once or twice a week high intensity training for 30 minutes. And now they still have the habit, but they're not so bored of doing 3 hours. They're just doing an hour. So this is very applicable for personal trainers too, is if you give them high intensity, they're going to adhere to it and you'll get more clients and you'll save the world, right? So that's my 2 cents. Left progressing pretty rapidly, getting close. From like a really scaled out perspective, the a huge amount of, because I genuinely believe that if you were able to propagandize or spread more information or spread the idea of high intensity to the masses, this is sounding almost political now, but if you could, I genuinely believe that there'd be at very least a massive fucking influx of fitter, stronger people. Undeniably, there's no way around it. If you really think about it, and I'm just seeing it demonstrably, thinking about it logically, you would have at least a large percentage of people who are now fitter and stronger. Yeah, and that's a good thing. Like, if there are more fitter, stronger people, then there's less of a tax burden on big pharma or medical. Big fat people being a big tax burden because they suffer the most health consequences. Older people would be living longer. They'd have better quality of life. People would have better quality of lives everywhere. Mental health would be better because exercise is great for mental health. We'd have less injuries. We'd just generally, from a medical perspective, mental and physical, the world would be at a better place, which is great for everybody. People would have more discipline because it requires some discipline to work out. But it's not that hard, and you then build your discipline up from an easy thing in, four exercises with 1-2 reps in reserve, to slowly building that up until you're like a full-fledged fucking, gym junkie. People getting fitter and fitter and more intense as the habit builds up, because you just can't jump into things too extreme off the get-go, or at least most people can't. So you have fitter, stronger, mentally more disciplined people all bonding over this thing where everyone's doing this high intensity thing. Everyone's just like, we're doing our new fad of 30 minutes once a week, but it's actually fucking working because muscles grow from intensity of effort and motor unit recruitment, not volume. So I genuinely think it would be really highly beneficial. That's the part though that's hard, is how do you market that to everybody on the fucking planet? How do you get everyone going? How does everyone get it into their head? I mean, unless they like taught it in the school system, I don't know, I don't know how that would happen, but obviously there are channels like me and people like me trying to spread the word of high intensity training. And I think for a lot of people, one of the things people get wrong with high intensity is they spread it under the false pretense that it's more optimal than everything else, which it's not. There are principles in high intensity that are optimal, but it's how you apply it. There are ways of applying high intensity to your training that isn't necessarily what you would call generic high intensity. You start doing more sets, you start doing more frequency. So the Dorian Yates Mike Mentor approach is not optimal, but to say it doesn't work is fucking retarded. It's maybe Dorian Yates' way of exercising is probably maybe 5-10% less efficient than a little bit more frequency of effort, but then it's also contextual. For him, he couldn't do more frequency because he was a genetic freak on steroids and he was super strong. So it depends on the person, but for the general populace, high intensity in the old school way of thinking isn't optimal, but it works almost just as good, potentially just as good for many people anyway. But the difference is, it shouldn't be so much that we spouting this idea that it's better than reps in reserve and frequency and volume. We should be spouting the idea that it's easier to adhere to. And that's much more mainstream, much more of an importance of the mainstream. The average 45-year-old soccer mom isn't listening to Mike Isertel tell you about how you should be training 52 sets a week with 15 reps in reserve, with RPE7, with fucking undulation and then periodization and fucking all these exercise science terminologies to maybe or may not optimize your training. They're trying to just find the way that makes their time and energy not spent. So, and that's high intensity. Ooh. also, from a independence perspective, having people like not a huge learning curve, high intensity is perfect too. Because if you want to get volume training right, it takes a lot of auto-regulation and quite a bit of knowledge on how to train. It's easy to fuck up, whereas high intensity is not. It's very easy to say to someone, go to the gym, get on leg press, which does all the work for you, find movements that don't require stability, because we're not learning technique, we just want the muscles purely stronger. We're not trying to get better at squats, we're trying to get stronger in our legs, the difference. So it's easy to say, go on a leg press, and take the reps extremely slowly. 5 seconds on the way up, 5 seconds on the way down, keep going until failure, or maybe a rep in reserve. Failure is easier to ascertain though, because new trainers can't tell how many reps in reserve they have a lot of time. So ideally just go to failure and then back it off if you want after that, once you ascertain what failure is. Give them an 8 to 12 rep range. If you get under 8, you have to lower the weight. If you get over 12, you have to increase the weight. Basics of progressive overload. You're not trying to progressively overload through sets or load or periodization. You're just simply increasing reps through failure and increasing through time. Very easy concept to understand. And once you have that, it's easy. Other than that, you basically just need what everyone gets when they go to the gym anyway. You get a fitness instructor who is pretty well qualified to show you how to leg press safely, machine press safely, machine row safely, and plank safely, or some exercise for your abs safely. Maybe not qualified to show you how to do fucking barbell bench press with leg drive and fucking arch and like lat engagement and shit, but you're not doing that. You're just doing machine shit, which is best for high intensity training anyway. So you would literally just need a fitness instructor to show you do those moves, which everyone gets that when you sign up to a gym. It's literally required by law, unless the person just declines, which you wouldn't in this case. And then you just understand that concept. Simple as, like, it's just fucking mad easy. Whereas if you want to get the most out of volume when you first start, which could be more beneficial, you then have to understand how much frequency you're doing. Indirect stimulus you get from different movements. You can't overhead press that frequently because you get plenty of indirect stimulus from the bench press. Your arm volume has to be less because you're getting indirect stimulus from there. You have to understand how to brace because you're doing all these sort of, you know, heavy compound movements, all these different technical things that would take fucking months to learn for many people. Whereas with high intensity, you just go, all right, progressively overload these four movements, go to failure, do it safely and slowly with good form. Do that once a week for 20 minutes. It's fucking like mind-bogglingly easy to do, and it will give you pretty fucking good results. But people, when you make things complicated, are less likely to adhere to it, especially when it's already long and hard and drawn out, like volume is. Oh, doing the wrong exercise. Fucking dickhead. Friction on my machine.